when it comes to learning, we are our own worst enemy. That we are actually the problem in learning. And then, of course, the good news becomes if we're the problem, we can be the solution. And so trying to make sense of, well, what is it we should do? Why don't we do it? And how can we move on? So if we dig in to learning, we certainly all can appreciate that, you know, learning is more important today, perhaps, than it's ever been. I would suggest that competitive advantage now is not a result of what we know or where we are, but rather how fast we can learn, right? It's transitory. Just because we're successful today doesn't guarantee that we're going to be successful tomorrow. And so briefly want to hit on kind of five dimensions that are really shaping the need for learning. This shift that I would suggest into not a knowledge economy anymore, but very much a learning economy. Satya Nadella from Microsoft captured it well, this idea, right? Ultimately, the learn-it-all will always do better than the know-it-all. First is thinking about routinization, right? We're getting better and better at taking what we know, consolidating it, putting into tools, technologies, and moving on to the next things, right? We've done this for centuries, right? Think about tools like, you know, plows and how that let us routinize certain things, but it's just going faster and faster. If we look at job growth over the last 30 years in the US, routine jobs are flat. On the other hand, it's the non-routine jobs where the growth is. So Ian mentioned things like AI, right? These changes that are taking place. If we're not a complement, if we're not able to use that to do even newer things, then we're simply going to get replaced by the technology. Second driver is specialization. Since at least Adam Smith, we've appreciated do something, do it narrowly, do it well. You have a chance to compete individually and organizationally. What's happening, though, is the rate at which we need to specialize is increasing ever faster. It's estimated in medicine, if you wanted to stay up to date with the latest advances, it would take you about 29 hours a day. Now, we see the math problem there, right? As we got 24, and we'd probably like to do some things like sleep, eat, spend time with friends, maybe practice medicine. And so there's not enough time, right? We're forced to specialize tighter and tighter in order to know something that we can compete on. But of course, that takes us to the third element, that as we specialize, we still have to integrate. We have to deliver a product. We have to deliver a service. That integration often requires working around the world, right? Bringing all of those pieces together. Fourth challenge that we can think about is just that, is globalization. For the last 30 years or so, as we've seen, you know, countries all over the world, but Brazil, Russia, India, China being four of the drivers, opening up, the global labor markets have been flooded with talent. Right? So individually, we have competition around the world. Organizationally, we have competition around the world. We have to be able to deal with that, which again means pushing that learning faster and faster. The last piece that I'll highlight is digitization. Right? This is tied to technology, but slightly different. Right? As we take what we know, we turn it into a digital form, we can now then share it ever more broadly. What's even more important is that we know that the marginal cost of that second digital item is often close to zero, right? So we invest, we create that digitized product service, think about software, right? And then we can sell it again and again. What that means and the implications for us in all sorts of different markets is it's becoming winner take all. If we don't win, if we finish in second place, you know, 10 years ago, we still could have a nice living, right? We try harder and we can make it work. Unfortunately, now we try harder isn't enough. We're likely to end up on the wayside. And so with these challenges we have in the learning economy, the question is, you know, where should we be focusing our attention? And so in the book and kind of more broadly, I highlight 8 different elements that I suggest are necessary for us to be dynamic learners. And so over the course of this morning, I want to talk about 3 of them. I want to focus on the process. I want to think about asking questions and also looking at the power of strengths. Very briefly, I'll mention the others as we look at failure, recognizing the challenge of how do we normalize failure? How do we accept that as part of that process, right? We saw the issue there in the Indian software services firm I mentioned up front. How do we make sure we're taking the time to step back, reflect, and recharge, not that we're always on? How do we rebel a little bit? Instead of conforming, making sure that we're ourselves, right? The challenge Steve Jobs once said, right? He hires people to tell him what to do, not for him to tell them what to do. So how do we make sure our people are empowered to tell us what to do as an organization so that they can learn, so that we can learn? Importantly, how do we build that experience in a T-shape, both that we're specialized in the areas we need to be in, as well as building out a variety of experience. And so those portfolios matter quite a bit. And then finally, recognizing that individual learning is not just an individual exercise, that learning from others is incredibly important. Galileo once said, no man is so ignorant that I can't learn something from him. So how do we take that seriously, both learning from them, but also recognizing that in teaching we learn, and so engaging that as part of our processes. But I want to dig into more depth first talk a little bit about process, right? And so anybody who's a fan of the NBA hasn't been able to avoid the Philadelphia 76ers and the trust the process mantra getting shouted again and again. The idea that sometimes results that we can see right now may not be an accurate reflection of what's going on. Right? And it's a broader point about learning. It's incredibly necessary for us to think about the process. Right? As we dig into process, we can find those opportunities. Love the quote from Tachi Ono, founder of Toyota Production System, who said, he who has no problem has the biggest problem of all. When we focus on the process, we find those problems. Take Dave Brailsford from Great Britain's Team Sky, the cycling team. As he thought about how do you build a great cycling team, he realized we needed to look at every step in the process. That included some obvious things. How do we train to be faster and have greater endurance? How do we eat to make sure that we're fueled properly? We have what we need. But also things on the side. How much sleep should we be getting? What pillow is going to give us the best sleep? What sort of massage gel is going to make sure that we recover faster and faster? Everything around getting 1% better. That focus on the process allows us to build out models, sometimes with analytics, sometimes up here in our head with a mental model, and gives us a discipline for improvement. But unfortunately, although process is incredibly important, we often don't do it, right? As I set up at the beginning, I said, look, operations identifies the processes for us, but behavioral science points out the problems.